And just in axiomatization of theoretical statistics, we can see simplify the model of functionist imagination. And as soon as the computer appears, people realize that it suffers from the force of initial art. In 70s, fundamentals of the theory of empirical inference, the VC theory was developed. It required not functionist imagination, but functional imagination. And I would like to stress this difference in my talk. And because of changing of problems, it was able to respond to the force. In the 90s, network empirical inference provided algorithms like SVM, boosting, neural net, that can generalize in very high dimensional space. And at the same time, appears new type of the problem of interest, where input space is 10,000. I think that soon we're talking about million dimensional space. And we saw that empirical inference worked in this situation. And I think that this is the future. And we should be prepared to work in high dimensional, very high dimensional spaces where you have relatively small number of observers. Let me start with axiomatization of probability theory and statistics. And also, it actually describes two types of inference, deductive and inductive inferences. Probably your study in course of statistics and probability theory is that just to axiomize the probability and statistics, Kolmogorov introduced in probability space, which contain X input space, omega I, sigma algebra of events, and P probability, which define probability measurement with sigma. And this is defined model of random events. And actually, theory of probability declares if you have this model, your problem is to estimate the chance of appearance of event of interest. And this is deductive, because you know everything about your probability space, and you know what you want, and you would like to deduct from this triplet some. But as soon as appear this statement, it's appear inverse problem, which called statistics. You have not triplet, but duplet, S and omega. And you have observations, X1, XL. And you need to find statistical law, probability measure, which will give you this triplet. And you understand as soon as you know this probability measure, everything is solved. So we now in position of theory of probability, and every problem of interest can be deducted from this triplet, and we have a rule for deduction. So actually, the core problem of all this business is to estimate the probability. As soon as this axiomatization appeared, it was proven theorem by Glinka and Pantelli that you can consider empirical distribution function, which is very simple construction. And this empirical distribution function converges to real distribution function. And in my notation here is f of A is real distribution function, which is probability that x doesn't exceed A. Or expectation of indicator function, which is the same. And then it was introduced a empirical distribution function. We just count how many points t is less than a. And we count how many points x is less than a, and then divide it by l, and we will have this stepwise function, which is called empirical distribution function. And immediately, as these two components was introduced, we get to concurrently prove that the largest deviation, the default deviation of empirical laws over empirical distribution function over real distribution function, it is probability that it will exceed epsilon is converged to zero for any epsilon. And it was interesting that immediately Kolmogorov approached that the rate of convergence is fast. And recently it was shown that it he proved in a hypothetical case, but recently Massad showed that it is true for any event. So immediately was recognized that empirical distribution function is a good estimate for real distribution function, and that means that it is possible somehow to create induction. This theorem will play a very important part in all our considerations. So let me give you examples to be sure that everything is clear. This is X, and this is that point is our observation. Suppose this is a real distribution function, and this is an empirical distribution function, FY. And what theorem here says that the largest deviation like that converges to zero when number of observations goes to but real multidimensional case started from two dimensions. So in two-dimensional case, again, this theorem is clear, it is true. But in this case, the step function is two-dimensional step function. You may, if you would like to estimate probability distribution function at this point, you just create these two lines and count how many points fail in this area over the number of observations. And this will be your empirical distribution function. And the same theorem of the event of Anteri proof, which says that it does converge to zero the empirical distribution function when the number of observations goes to zero. At the same time, I use Fisher philosophy. Fisher was not a mathematician, he was a biologist and interested in treating of biological experiments. And he introduced some simplified version of statistics. He introduced the problem of estimating unknown probability measure to the problem of estimating unknown parameters of the density. And actually, unknown fixed number of parameters. And he suggests to use appropriate model to define parametric function of density that contain desired function. We use the last maximum likelihood method to estimate parameters of density. And then he suggests construct efficient algorithm, and efficient in some sense we will discuss. So let me give you examples. And this is classical statistics. And this example actually probably all classical books on statistics. What is the problem? Suppose you would like to estimate function f0 from x, and you have your observations, x1, y1, x1, yl, xl. So you have l2. So first of all, in Fisher's paradigm, you know that your function, a known function, belong to some family function. Which have parameters, and parameters belong to n-dimensional, at least n-dimensional here. And then he suggests that there is a model of observation, which is a real function plus some noise. And this is an important part that noise doesn't correlate with this function of measurement. If you have this model, you can estimate noise, which is different between whatever you see and the real function. And then he suggests to introduce law that defines this noise. So in this example, it is normal distributed noise is 0 d. And his idea of inductive inference was just use maximum likelihood method. So just put probability measure here, because you know this observation. You can divide your probability measure up to its parameter. And you will have on the right hand side this expression. And method of inference to maximize likelihood, that's called maximum likelihood method, which we introduced. And the subject of analysis is quality of parameters. So the goal is to approximate parameters of density, but because of your model, it will be parameters of your function which you desire to estimate. And the subject of analysis is quality of parameters estimation, consistency, asymptotic normality, efficiency, everything of all this concept actually was suggested by. And in 60s, when computers appeared, Bellman, actually, he was first who saw that this increasing dimensionality of the problem, the amount of resources that one needs to solve the problem of interest increased in exponentially. And this is a very simple example. If you need to estimate some smooth function in one-dimensional case, which can be expanded in Fourier series, you suppose you need n pair. If you consider the same type of approximation in n-dimensional space, you need n to the given number of terms. And if you need, say, to have c examples over one parameter, so all together you need huge amount of parameters c n to the given. And for real high-dimensional space, it looks non-linear. So, and it was a real tragedy in the 60s because people realized that using classical approach, it is impossible to generalize in a reasonable dimension. Right? I'm not talking about high-dimensional space. Say, in 20-dimensional space, it was a problem from flash. And something happened at this time. Rosenblatt suggests his model of brain called perceptron, and he demonstrates just practically that perceptron can generalize in 400-dimensional space using not long amount of examples. And it boosted to the development of theory. So at this time was introduced theory of minimizing of empirical. What is so minimizing the risk functionality in the data. So you have function, set of functions, u, zeta, alpha, which is set of log functions. Alpha belong to lambda, it's not necessarily a parametric set of functions, any function. And you would like to minimize this set of functions if probability measures are known by the given data. And that's is problem of minimizing risk function. But we can show that all classical problems which are interested in, say, path recognition, regression estimation, density estimation, can be described like as a general scheme just by specification what is the log function. So for path recognition, you're considering system like y takes two values, minus one or plus one, and x belongs to d-dimensional space. And you have this specific log, one over two y minus, with a value of indicator function. So it can be all zero or one. So you actually put in this log function in your function now, and you integrate it over a mistake. So it's described, this function is described. Probability of mistakes, and your goal is to minimize the probability of mistakes if probability measure is unknown, but you didn't. If you have regression function, you again have very specific concept of loss function, which is slowing loss like that. And in this case, you have real function y and vector b. And again, you put your loss function in functional, you can show the regression that is that function. So the goal was to minimize expected loss. But how to minimize? We should introduce something instead. And it was very, very, say, not clear answer how to do that. Just people suggest to minimize empirical risk. So, and this induction principle, this is the principle, because instead of minimizing expected loss, which you cannot minimize, You should suggest to minimize something else. And somehow it happens that people suggest to minimize the critical loss, which not necessarily, and now it is the problem, is it minimizing empirical loss the best strategy to do? It is unclear. But whatever we did, and all theory which we're discussing now is come from minimizing of empirical risk functional. And also we will consider structural discrimination, which are repeated generalization of the same type of approach. But this is the most advanced inductive principle which we know. So let us minimize the number of mistakes on our training data or the value of empirical loss in more general case. And we will take the value, the parameters alpha which minimize our empirical loss as a value of parameters which minimize our real loss. So the question arises, when empirical discrimination method is consistent? And how well does empirical risk approximate? And this is actually all theory of learning that is about this research. Try to find the necessary sufficient conditions where you can use this method and try to get a bound when you're using this method. Or more general structure. So before I will start to discuss what was done in the theory, let me say that actually all methods which we use, even in classical studies, reflection of this empirical risk minimization idea of induction principle. So when we're looking for, say, function which, for pattern recognition, we're trying to pick up function which minimize the number of training data. So that is pick up parameter which minimize the number of training errors. In regression estimation, it will do everything correctly. We have least, the least squares method, which is well known from classical studies. In this estimation, it will have maximum length. So it looks like this work is converged, but what is the difference between classical statistics and Fisher understanding of the goal of the theory, a new one. So in Fisher way, you require to estimate parameters. And the good estimate is where our estimated parameters close to whatever function is describing the real solution. Or we can talk about closeness in functional space, which is the same. So actually what we want in Fisher's statement to find model of the random process. But empirical inference goal is slightly different. We would like to have empirical loss, which is close to the smallest possible loss. So if alpha defines the smallest possible loss, and this guy is what we found, we don't care about how close this function. We just wanted to have the smallest possible loss. And this makes a big difference. So you're trying to predict output of experiment well, but not necessarily to estimate model well. And the all achievement which we have now, it is not your mathematical trick. The classical statistics is perfect from mathematical point of view, but due to changing philosophy from estimating model of events to estimating the best predictor. So let me give you an example to show what is the difference. So suppose we have pattern recognition problem, and we have the red dots and the black dots, and we would like to separate them. And we have two solutions. One is black line, and this is the second is blue food. From the point of view of Fisher idea of estimating of functions, they're very different. So this is line, and this is polynomial of high degree, and coefficients is very, very good. But from point of view of empirical loss, they're very close, because they separate training data approximately in the same way, and probably they will separate equally well. So, and this actually example illustrates what we would like to do. We don't care about function, the real function, which was in mind. So, which define this problem. You would like to approximate function in this way. So, this is the way of waiting. What is theory about? Suppose we do it with empirical distribution data. We can find the function which minimizes empirical loss. Suppose we can do that. And then we will put the best function in expected function. What is real loss? And what will give you empirical loss? If you have axis where this is number of observations, as number of observations increase, empirical risk will increase because it will be more and more difficult to explain the data. But expected loss will decrease. So actually you have gaps between empirical loss and expected loss. And the subject is of theory is to estimate how deep it is. And also our conceptual problem is this to put conversion on. They are not necessarily. So the problem actually also is the problem is about estimating is this converge and what is it done. And this is very important theory, which was one of the last in the theory of justification of empirical reasoning. It is very general. It says that if you have a set of functions which satisfy very general conditions, so the expectation is not just functions, then empirical risk minimization gap is consistent if and only if uniform convergence takes place. That's a little bit not straightforward definition of consistency. It should be strong consistent. But let's think about consistent. It's not difficult. So it is unusual and not clear that it should be like that, because we are looking for a function which approximate where it was, but it depends on whole set of functions. Not on one function in your set, but because you're looking for supremum over there, that means that it depends on the whole set of your functions. So actually to guarantee that you don't have gap at the end of when L goes to infinity, it depends on the set of functions, but not on specific functions. And let me come back to Glevenko-Kantele theory. When they started to consider this state, the very first theory about statistics, and talk about the Glevenko-Kantele theory, it says that uniform convergence over this set of functions, which is defined by lines, always exists. But actually the problem is that if you define our subset in more funny way like that, it is unclear if exists uniform convergence or not. If it exists theorem which is exactly equivalent to Glevenko-Kantele theorem, but not over this subset, but over this subset. And this is our general thing now. The whole theory is continuation of Glevenko-Kantele line, because we would like to have theorem which was discovered by Glevenko-Kantele for very simple set of events to arbitrary set. And we would like to describe when in ordinary set of events, certain situation like in the Glevenko-Kantele case, and when it is not. And actually, this describes two main problems. We need to find conditions when empirical process is consistent. That is exactly what we would like to find. And according to previous theorem, we know that it's necessary conditions and sufficient conditions for empirical risk visualization principle to be consistent. And the second find non-asymptotic rate of burden. So generalized Kolmogorov one, but not for Glivenko-Konterik one-dimensional case, but for any dimensional case in any set of events. And that's what by Howard Kolb's concept of capacity. He said that exists some general concept of capacity of the set of functions which actually give you necessary sufficient. I would like to discuss part recognition case, but the same for recursion case, I don't want just some textual generalization. And we can define three important concepts which define necessary sufficient conditions for the first concept. The first is called DC entropy, and the second is gross function. It's called DC entropy because it is different from Kolmogorov's epsilon entropy. And actually, epsilon entropy was defined for convergence in function space, and DC entropy useful for convergence in function of space. So let me describe what is this. Suppose you give those devices, Mr. One, Mr. Two, and you would like to separate, and your set of functions is set of indicator functions, which can take two values, minus one and plus one. What is this event? So if you have L different functions, you can consider the number of how many different separations of this vector you can construct using this indicator function. Actually, less than 2 to the L. But it can be much less, and you can describe it by this version. So if you take logarithm from this version, and then take expectation, you have a quantity which calls DC vector. So this value depends on your set of functions and on your observation. And here, by taking the expectation, you exclude your set of functions, your observation, and just depend on your set of functions, on probability measure, and on the number. That's called DC entropy. But what is wrong in DC entropy? It is useful when you know what it is, when you know the probability measure. But in our business, we mostly don't know probability measure. Then you can construct something which is called gross function. You take maximum over one beta L and of this quantity. So it's actually upper bound any possible probability measure. That's called gross function. And in 68, we found the gross function possess very interesting property. It's actually a very important property. It's not just for statistics. It's just for many branches of science. So gross function or linear is this property. Or if it's not linear, it is logarithmic. Except this is false. So the theorem says that it cannot be in between linear and logarithmic, say square root from that. It just has a two possibilities. Or to be linear, or if it's not linear, then it will be logarithmic. And if it's possible to, and it says even more that you can find the coefficient in front of logarithmic estimate as the largest L where your gross function, which depends actually on L, still linear. It goes like linear and then becomes logarithmic. And that is all. And this value where it is becomes logarithmic, it's called feasibility. So this is a very important theorem. And you probably know that if this dimension is finite, you can do everything. If this dimension is not
another definition of the C dimension which people use in and actually that was how it was discovered. First it was introduced growth function, and then it was discovered that growth function has this bubble. But people from computer science, they prefer equivalent definition, which is slightly different. So again, you have this observation, and you know that there exists in the L different way to divide the set into two subsets, and you say that that set of indicator function shatter just left us if all two to the L separation are possible using this indicator. And set of indicator functions has this dimension H if there exists H vectors that can be shattered using this set. And there are no H plus one vectors that can be shattered using this set. So that's just different definition, which can you can see is the definition of this theorem of series theorem. Well, this is example for fighter planes of the plane, and you can shatter a few points, but you cannot shatter four because it will be a situation like that where you cannot shatter. And it was proven also that necessary and sufficient conditions is the following. If you have fixed probability measure, so for fixed probability measure, your necessary and sufficient conditions is entropy over number of observations to go to zero. For it is necessary and sufficient. If you would like to have for any probability measure, then growth function to go to zero when L goes to infinity, and also the C dimension should be fine. So everything is described in the term of capacity. So now I would like to show how actually what is the proof. The proof is very simple. The first is synchronization inequality, the proof synchronization inequality. And this is, by the way, very important. In recent development, we use that approximately the same inequality, say, using the automatic complexity, it is the same actually. But what is important here, if you know transduction, and we will probably talk about transduction later, so the first step is to prove that you can do induction by consider transduction. This is synchronization inequality, it is actually, we will talk about this later, but it is a very important step, which cannot be avoided, and it has very important implication in philosophy of physics. And then you have very technical step, you're proving the distribution-dependent bound, distribution-dependent bound, and bound-dependent distribution. This is the best bound, this is the worst bound, because you ignore distribution function. And here you have the worstest bound of the series, because you approximate your growth function by one parametric function. What we're doing when we're using this dimension, we're just using one parameter to approximate growth function. And immediately from this inequality, you can have this bound, which is completely equivalent, it's probability 1 minus theta, you have upper and lower bound of this function. And this is in terms of entropy, growth function, and this so as soon as you have this bound, you actually can construct new induction. And it depends, it can be explained in the following way. So you have bounds, which bound expected loss as sum of empirical loss plus some confidence interval, and then you try to minimize this right hand side. If you fix capacity, then just one player empirical loss. But if you would like to have more players, you have to introduce a structure from your set of functions, increase capacity, and play both over empirical loss and over. And what was interesting that it was proven the structural discretization principle is strongly universal. So, just I described the way to nothing behind that more. You can refine bomb, you can introduce new concept for getting bomb, but it will be the same. But philosophical implication from that and algorithmical implication from this general theory are very interesting. Because first of all, it somehow looks like we're talking about, when we talked about this dimension, about the same quantities what was described before. We would like to minimize this dimension and simultaneously compare to smallest empirical box. But it looks like it is the same, like Occam suggested, that it should not be multiplied by your necessity. So don't use more parameters than you need to. And this is interpretation. But structuralist minimization principle is different. It can be described as explain absorb fact using function from the subset with the smallest specific dimension. And interpretation, I don't want to talk about that, but who knows, Popper's non-specified PDP, it is exact Popper's non-specified PDP. Explain your fact using theory which is easy to falsify. If you don't know, please keep it. But the crucial question is this dimension equal to the number of times? And it is not. And I give you an example where, say, this dimension of hyperplane is equal to the number of parameters. Two-dimensional case I gave before, but now you can see that it is possible to prove that it has this dimension of hyperplane and n-dimensional case, n plus 1, and this is the number of parameters. But this example, which demonstrates that you can have only one parameter, and this dimension will be infinite. If you have a sign alpha f, and alpha belongs to one, if it is just parameter, can take any value, you can get so high checks that you can separate in all possible ways using this set of functions. So, this is dimension one, and number of parameters one, and this is dimension two. But more interesting case when it's vice versa, when number of parameters is large, and this dimension is small. And this concept can be constructed by using hyperplane with margin. Just not separate your data, but separate with some margin, delta. And it is it was proven theorem which says that this dimension is bounded by sum of two values, one and smallest of this two values. And which is dimensionality or ratio R, which is radius where your data meaning and delta, which is margin. So if this R over delta is smaller than dimensionality, then your dimension is smaller than dimensionality. Otherwise, your general situation is described this dimension of linear set of functions. And actually, this idea give us support vector machine. Increase the number of agents. Why increase much, say, your input vector in high-dimensional future space and control this dimension in high-dimensional space by constructing large models. That was the idea behind support vector. And the idea was that in spite of the fact, if you're doing smart, you can work in the way where margin increases, but radius doesn't increase, or data reading is not increasing the loss. But suppose we can do that, then we can control capacity and generalization activity by margin, but not by the channel. Yeah. And I think this example large margin to hyperplane. I think that you know, all of you know, you have lectures about that. But what is important here, that if you increase one, and you will move in parallel with the type of lane, you will match, say, some vectors here and here. They are support vectors. And if you remove the rest vectors, and you try to construct again type of lane, you will construct the same type of lane. This is just technical definition, what is large margin. I don't want to discuss this. So actually, there's no minimal this norm under this constraint. And you can have a formal solution, which is this quadratic integration problem. You can generalize for non-separable case. I don't want to repeat whatever you have heard many times. And this is, and also you can have a mapping in high dimensional space using this Kerman trick. And I don't think that I should spend time explaining to you Kerman tricks because you probably have lectures about Kerman tricks a lot. But I just want to mention that Kerman trick is, can be used a lot of kernels, and just one restriction is Kerman trick should be positive. Should satisfy positive of Mercer, and you can do that. And this is support vectors in the space of features. You just, instead of inner product in input space, take kernels, and the same is the rest. Again, have the same kind of plane. You have kind of plane. These examples of kernels, I don't think so I would like just mention one new interesting point. That it was, so I just give you an example of prediction of molecular bioactivity, which was done by Jason and his co-authors. He used in very high dimensional space once, 39,000 dimensional space, 2,000 vectors, and separate them, and did very well. But what is most impressive here, this is a typical competition on this data set, this is the number of competition CPA, and Jason gets 74, and this is different here, it is transductive, instead of conductive. What is most interesting here, just changing velocity from induction to transduction gives increasing performance more than, say, than using smart algorithms and say, not so smart algorithms. So I would like and I think that the future development will be in transductive and more, say, narrow type of inferences than induction. So my point is, that more or less in inductive inferences give you both whatever. Okay. But in the way how they reject classical statistics because it does more than we need, it estimates functions, but we would like to estimate function now with doubt. The same happens in transduction. We try to estimate function the decision rule which minimizes probability of error. But our goal to minimize number of errors on the trade on the test data. And this is different. So this is the definition of transduction. What is transduction? Suppose you view both training data and test data, but test data without classification. And how using both to estimate classifications for unknown classification point, for test point. Not given, not trying to estimate decision rule, but try to estimate instead of function vector, just vector for test data. Why it is better than estimating vector? Because as soon as you have your space, which now is discrete space and contains your training data after that, your test data, you don't use wire. So you have discrete space. It contains L plus K and K And when you have set of functions, you actually have not a set of limiting functions, but finite number of equivalent classes. The two functions are equivalent if they separate this data in the same way. And among these classes equivalence, it can be a large equivalent class, it can be a small equivalent class. And the problem is to separate the way that you can do it with high, with large equivalent classes. And this will affect your problems. When very beginning we introduced symmetrization theory, actually in symmetrization theory it is exactly the same case. So what we did with generalization first, we have our training data x and y, and we would like to have y, which difference between average of you say of this data and this data, you get it small. So to prove induction, we actually using transduction, and there are no way, I don't know way how you can prove general induction theory without using transduction idea. So that means that the transductive idea more basic than induction. And here it is a lot of room for improvement. And I think that the problem now not just to concentrate on transductive inference, but try to find something more simple than transductive. And let me give you example of more simple problems than transductive, where you can have even advantage of There are a lot of problems like that. Given training data and given test data, find key elements of the test data which is most probability belong to the first class. That's it. You don't need separate, you don't need label your test data. Your goal is just pick up key elements which is most probability belong to the first class. And many problems of interest can be described in this way, for example, in the Jason problem of classification of candidates for draft. You don't need to classify all candidates, because the most difficult part will be classify candidates which is the border between good and bad. But your goal to find state candidates which is most probability will belong to the first one. And I believe that as soon as you will solve this problem, but you will have an additional advantage over transductive inference. As much as you have say, advantage transductive inference over inductive. So that means that don't make something else, that right? So I just finished the story, what happens till now. And now I would like to come back and a little bit discuss with you what actually happened for the last 70 years. I settled the law. So in Soviet, Kolmogorov introduced approximation of probability. So actually, from this point, it starts more or less accurate discussion on that. And it immediately connected the general problem of statistics to analysis of empirical event contented process. And it is very interesting. I have no time today to discuss Popper's definition of demarcation between metaphysics and empirical sciences. And this is based on theory of first fighting. And if you will read accurately Popper, it's very, very close to this definition. For this question, in so this Fisher introduced paradigm of applied statistics as a view of estimating model of observed event. And that was mistake. Because in general Kolmogorov settings, it was more general than the model of event. He actually suggested to solve impost problems and all implications from impost statements in practice. And he divided element of future theory, which now is statistic, information matrix, consistency, asymptotic normality, efficiency, and all these concepts are non-linear in statistical learning theory because they're talking about parameters, but not about function. And it was set in the late 60s. And very, very important event it is discovery of pure positrons. I don't think that we now understood in the full extent how great it is, how deep it is problem, and whatever I talk with people, let's do, functional estimation, but not estimation of functions. Let's do transductive difference, but not inductive. Let's do selective difference. It is trying to solve, instead of pure cost problem, better cost problem. Just in this way, nothing more. And all advantages which we can get, we get from just from this idea to escape solving pure cost problem. So it's happened in the 60s, where for the first time people understood that it does exist and it is deep problem. And Kolmogorov and Tikhonov developed capacity concept, epsilon, RT, covering number, heat, all these capacity concepts, but they developed it for functions. But nevertheless, for the first time, it was important, it was stressed importance to consider not just the definition of smoothness function or detail of the function, but it is important that it plays in statistics plays great role capacity. And Vatsika Chevanyan is the
main elements of empirical processes.
So based on new capacity concept, equivalent class, DC entropy, it was decade. And actually empirical inference due to computer became natural. And all this happened in the 60s. Of course, great time 60s. Even now, when say Leo talked about 60s, he came back to the 60s and pick up optimality here. Very interesting because in history of science there is a fast time and time when nothing happened. So in certain happened a lot. In 60s happened a lot. But say next time it happened in 90s, when it is a necessary execution condition for consistency. Estimation in high dimensional functional space. So, estimation of high-dimensional spaces became an afterthought. And for the first time, people recognized that using algorithms, using margins like STM, boosting, neural net, we can do in high-dimensional spaces. And it was impossible, say, 30s, even think about that. Then 2020. You know, you don't feel it yet, what's that? But from my point of view, it is certain the greatest idea. And maybe in my following slides, I will describe you the greatest idea. Just we understood that what actually mathematics does before. They try to generalize, to solve as general problem as before. They did not realize that you could pay price. And the price is still positive. So, and for the first time, we understood that there is a transductive, which if you not play this computer, it is not interesting because it is not general. But as soon as you start to play these computers and take advantages in your interest, transductive inference becomes very important. We hope it. So, for the first time, the inference is very bad connotation in philosophy became main player because you would like to solve real life problems. And from my point of view, the most important is the change generation of scientists. You cannot imagine how different it was to do learning theory 30 years ago. Competition will kill you. So they don't accept on any statistical conferences. People did not publish in statistical magazines because it was different. But now it's a new generation of scientists, which understand much better than classical statistics. They can learn about what's happening. And you don't need any more talk to our own meeting is now quite to give a talk to what's happening here. Because from their point of view, it is impossible to generalize this kind of thing. Actually, people realize that the only way that you can achieve something. The theory which we do.
And also there is a philosophical perspective. It is not just we have a lot of data, a lot of articles. We moving with very small steps. We cannot see what's happening. But I was rich, and I can tell you that in the end of '60s, because previous the classical statistics to it cannot apply to high dimensional growth. It became clear for the first time in '60s when Bellman introduced this course of dimensionality, people started using computers, using classical algorithms. And then in '90s, it became clear that quantum relativity of induction is inferences restricted,
because experiments
use SVM boosting and neural contradictions. They don't decrease dimensionality. Vice versa, you decrease dimensionality. You're looking for matter. So generalization ability is not connected to dimensionality, it's connected to something else. Maybe we can refine this concept, but it will not be for sure dimensionality of this concept. At the beginning of 2000, it became clear that classical model of science is restricted because it does not accept transductive and ad hoc inferences, which are more accurate than inductive inferences. It's not easy to prove in general when transductive inferences is better than inductive. Because of the decision lemma, you cannot prove induction results in the decision lemma. So that means that that contains part of the bond of transductive bond. And in the beginning of 2000, it became clear that in creating new philosophy of science, the problem of empirical inference will play the same role like in physics plays, like physics plays in creating old philosophy. So I would like to stress that our science became very important, not just because you're solving many interesting problems, but because people will think differently. And let me give you what is changing, what will change in philosophy. So let me give you how